So we go from there, yeah.
Okay. Oh, Lord, we thank you for this beautiful day, and Lord, the eyes that were opened within each one of us to see and experience the beauty of yours and others around us, and how you even use us, Lord, to... Lord, not use in the sense that we are unconscious of your work through us, but Lord, enable us to labor with you in the lives, the precious lives around us that you place under our care and under our influence. Lord, I pray that we would continue to have pure and righteous hearts, Lord, as we engage in this work. With you and with others. Lord, I know each one of us, each in our own way and through the peculiar way that you lead each one of us, Lord, hunger and thirst for your truth and your righteousness to be made known in the way that we live our lives. Lord, we desire to be a truly selfless people, Lord, to live in such a mode of life where we are no longer self-centered, self-oriented, Lord, but that we live in the freedom that comes through a life in your spirit. Father, the process of getting there is in itself, Lord, such a beautiful thing. And in fact, it's the great thing that you heart towards. Lord, even yet yesterday we spoke of the timing of your work. Lord, in a sense, the eternal's instruction and influence over this temporal life. Lord, how all things must go through, Lord, a process in which we learn and grow. Very few things are instantaneous, and we bless you for that, Father. So, Lord, may we walk in wisdom and learn to appreciate the process in life. Lord, in doing that, there will never really be any times where we are truly discouraged or lacking, where we know that you are things. And as Oswald Chambers would say, we are not matured in spite of our circumstances, but in and through them. So Lord, maybe recognize this.
That's true.
Registered parts. So I pray these things in Jesus' name.
Jesus' name. Well, first, let's talk about our schedule. I think yesterday, a man called me in about the 4 o'clock, basically, wanted to meet with me. I think, oh, weekend time is the time. He's available, me available as well. So I totally forgot that we were discussing, have a lunch together to discuss our time. So I had a lunch appointment and then point with him. He's going to pick me up about 10:30. So I think we're going to stick with our schedule, 9 to 10, which is in my plan. And then we'll go from there, discuss certain things, Chinese stuff that, you know. So if you want to meet later on, might be had about dinner time or something. I think you're working in the afternoon, am I right? So, yeah, that's impossible. So let's let's do 9 to 10, do some preliminary discussion, discoveries. Go from there, okay? So in the mornings on Saturday. So
okay.
Yeah.
You still want to do that online, I'm guessing, right?
Yeah, you could come over if you want to. I don't think that's a thing, you know. You can even have lunch with us if you want to. So yeah, so.
Oh, I don't want to intrude on your time.
Oh, no. I think it's okay. After that, you know, he and I can have our own time so as well. So yeah. I don't know yet. So let's talk about tomorrow, okay? So the time, when's the year, so we're going to in communication, okay?
Yeah.
So, yeah. So we can do online. No. So yeah, let's do online for now. So thinking about this. So let's start Wednesday. We're going to continue to do this reading. Okay, we're going to start some prophetic books. Is that okay? You know, sometime we might visit some psalms. I really don't hear his expressing on psalm tree, making sense to you. You know, so yeah. But let's start with this two major prophets. Exposition on the Holy Scriptures by Alexander McLaren. We are in the set of books called Isaiah and Jeremiah. Are you with me there? So yeah, I'm going to go through the first portion now. Start with Isaiah. The title is The Greedy Suit. Jehoram versus Judah. Are we on the same page, am I right? Okay. The vision of Isaiah the son of Amos, which he saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem in the days of Uzziah. Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah, kings of Judah. Hear, O heavens, and give ear, O earth. For the Lord has spoken, have nourished and brought up children. They have rebelled against me. The ox knows his owner, as the ass his master's crib. But the Israel does not know. My people does not consider. Ah, sinful nation of people laden with iniquity, a seed for evildoers, children that are corruptors. They are forsaking the Lord. They have provoked the Holy One of Israel unto anger. They're gone away, backward. Why should ye be stricken any more? Ye will reward more and more the whole head sick and the whole heart faint. From the sole of the foot, even unto the head, there is no soundness in it, but wounds and bruises, the putrefying sores. To have been closed, neither bound up, neither mollified with ointment. Your country is desolate, your cities are burned with fire, your land stranger devoured in your presence. It is desolate, as overthrown by strangers. As the daughter of Zion is left as a cottage in a vineyard, as a lodge in a garden of cucumbers, as a besieged city, except the Lord hosts and left unto us a very small remnant. We shall have been as a Sodom, and we should have been like unto Gomorrah. Wash you, make you clean. Put away the evil of your doings from before my eyes. Cease to do evil. Learn to do well, seek judgment, relief the oppressed, judge the fatherless, plead for the widow. Come now, and let us reason together, says the Lord. So your sins be as a scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. So they be red like crimson, they shall be as a wool. If you be willing and obedient, you shall eat the good of the land, but if you refuse and rebel, you shall be devoured with the sword. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken it. Isaiah 1, 1 to 9, 16 to 20. The first bar's great overture to Isaiah's great oratorium are here sounded. It's the first chapter, giving out the themes which run through all the rest. It's the prophecies. Like most introductions, they are probably written last when the prophet collected and arranged his life's labors. The text deal with the three great thoughts, the leitmotifs that are sounded over and over again in the prophet's message. First comes great indictment, verse 2 to 4. A true prophet word out of a universal application, even when they are most especially addressed to a particular audience. This is because this indictment was so true of Judah, it is true of all men, but is not concerned with detail peculiar to a long past period and state of a society, but with the broad generalities common to us all. Another great teacher in Old Testament times said, I will not reprove thee for thine sacrifice, nor as a burnt offering to have been continued before me, as they have nothing to say about ritual or ceremonial omissions, which to him were but surface matters after all. But it says in blazing light the foundation facts of Judah and every man's distorted relation to God. How lovingly, as well as sternly, God speaketh through him. The divine lament which heralded the searching indictment is not unworthy to be the very word of the almighty lover of all men, soaring over his prodigal and fugitive sons. Nor is the deep truth less than its tenderness, for it is not man's sin blackest when sinning against the bright background of God's fatherly love. True, the fatherhood that I said knew referred to God's relation to the nation rather than to the individual, but the great truth which is perfectly revealed by the perfect Son was in part shown to the prophet. The east was bright with unrising sun, and the tinted cloud that hovered about the place of his rising seemed as if yearning to open and let him through. Man's neglect of God's benefits put him below the animals that know the hand that feeds as God wins them. Some men think it a token of a superior culture at once we use to throw off allegiance to God. It's a token that they have less intelligence than their dog. There's something very beautiful and pathetic in the fact that a Judah is not directed as rest. But the verses 2-4. And a divine soliloque, how to pronounce that word? Soliloque. I'm sorry. Don't know what that means even.
Soliloquy.
Soliloquy, which is...
it's like a
monologue.
Okay.
Okay. They might rather be called a father's lament than an indictment. The forsaking father, as it were, sadly brooding over his erring children's, every child's sins, which are his father's sorrows and his own miseries. In verse 4, the black catalogue of the prodigal's doings begins on the surface with what we call moral delinquencies, and then digs deeper to disclose the root of those what we call religious relationship perverted. The two are inseparably united, for no man who is wrong with God can be right with duty, or with man. Notice, too, how one word flashes into clearness the sound truth of universal experience, that iniquity, however it may delude us into fancying that by it we throw off the burden of a conscience and duty, pile heavier weights on our backs. The doer of iniquity is laden with iniquity. Notice too how the awful intel of evil from parents to children is adduced, shall we say, as aggravating as lessening the guilt of each generation. Isaiah's contemporaries are a seed of evildoers, spring from such, and in their turn are chosen that are corruptors. The fetal bias becomes stronger and it passes down. Heredity is a fact, whether you call it original sin or not. But the bitter fountain of all evil lies in distorted relations to God. They have forsaken the Lord. That is why they do corruptly. They have despised the Holy One of Israel. That is why they are laden with iniquity. Alienated the heart, separated from him, to forsake him is to despise him. To go from him is to go away backward. whether it may have been our inheritance evil, we should go further from him. And this fatherly lament over Judah is indeed a wail over every child of man. That is not echo in the pearl of parables, and may we not suppose it is suggested as a supreme revelation of man's misery and God's love. After the indictment comes the sentence. Verse 5 to 8. Bamber's sentence is not altogether accurate, for these verses do not so much decree the future as describe a present, that the deep tone of pitying wonder wounds through them at the tale of the bitter harvest sown by sin. The penitent question, why will ye be still stricken, and ye reward more and more, brings out the solemn truth that all which men gain by rebelling against God is a chastisement. The ox that kicks against the pricks only makes it its own hawks bleed. We aim some imagine good that we get blows. No rational answer than stern why is it possible. Every sin that lacks for unreason is essentially an absurdity. The consequences of Judah's sin at first darkly drawn on the metaphor of a man desperately wounded in some fight and far away from physicians or nurses. Then the metaphor is interpreted by the plain fact of hostile invasion, flaming cities, devastated fields. The choice in coherence of the verses to take the gruesome picture of the wounded man as a description of man's sins. It's plainly a description of the consequences of sins. In accordance with the Old Testament point of view, Isaiah deal with national calamities as the punishment for national sins. It does not touch on the far worse result of individual sins on individual character, but while we are not to ignore his doctrine that the nations are individual entities, and that the righteous and exalted the nation in our days as well as in his, the Christian form of his teaching is that man lay waste their own lives and wounded their own souls by every sin. The fugitive son comes down to be a swineherd and cannot get enough even of the swine's food to stay his hunger. The note of pity sounds were clearly in the pathetic description of the deserted daughter of Zion. Jerusalem stand forlorn and defenseless, like a frail booth in a vineyard, his city run up with both open to fierce sunshine or howling winds. Once beautiful for situation, the joy of the whole earth, the city of the great king. And now, verse 9 breaks the solemn flow of the divine voice that breaks it as a desire to be broken. But in its hearts made soft, petitioned by the voice, breathes out lowly acknowledgement of widespread sin, and see God's mercy in the continuance of a very small remnant of still faithful ones. There is a little island not yet submerged by the seal of iniquity. It is to him, not to themselves, that the holy seed on their being kept from following the multitude to do evil. What a smiting comparison with the national pride that is as a Sodom, like under Gomorrah. After the sentence comes pardon, verse 16 and 17 probably belong to the paragraph omitted from the text and close a stern special word to the rulers, which in its severe tone contrasts so strongly with the wounded love and great pity of the preceding verses. Moral amendment is demanded of these high place sinners and false guides. It is John the Baptist's message in the earlier form. It is clears the way for the evangelical message. Repentance and cleansing of life comes first. But these stern requirements of taking a long candle despair will soon make you clean. Easy to say, plainly necessary, and as plainly hopelessly above my reach. If that is all that a prophet has to say to me, he may as well say nothing. What is the use of saying arise, walk to the man who has been lame from his mother's womb? How can a full body be washed clean but filthy hands? Ancient or modern preachers of self-wrought morality exhort to impossibilities unless they follow the preaching of an untenable ideal as Isaiah followed his. They are doomed to waste the word. He cried, make you clean. But immediately went down the point one could make clean. Could turn scarlet into snowy white, crimson to the lustrous purity of the unstained fleeces of a sheep in green pastures. The assurance of God's forgiveness with deal with the guilt and of God's cleansing with the deal with inclination and habit must be the foundation of our cleansing ourselves from filthiness of the flesh and the spirit. The call to repentance need the promise of pardon and divine help to purify in order to become a gospel. And the call to repentance towards God and faith towards our Lord Jesus Christ is what we all who are laden with iniquity and have forsaken the Lord need if ever we are to cease to do evil and learn to do well. With one thunderclap, the prophecy closes. Pearling forth internal eternity set before every soul of man. Willing obedience to our Father God secures all good, the full satisfaction of our else hungry and ravenous desires. To refuse and rebel is to condemn ourselves to destruction. And no man can avert that consequence or break the necessary connection between goodness and blessedness. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken it, and what it speaks stand fast forever and ever. Wow. Such wonderful writer or teacher. Bless the Lord. Go ahead.
The stupidity of godlessness. The ox knoweth his owner, and the ass his master's crib. But Israel doth not know, my people doth not consider. Isaiah 1, verse 3. This is primarily an indictment against Israel, but it touches us all. Doth not know, in other words, has no familiar acquaintance with, doth not consider, in other words, frivolously ignores, never meditates on. 1. This is a common attitude of mind towards God. Indifference towards Him is far more frequent than conscious hostility. Take 100 men at random as they hurry through the streets. How many of them would have to acknowledge that no thought of God had crossed their minds for days or months? So far as they are concerned, either in regard to their thoughts or actions, He is a superfluous hypothesis. Most men are not conscious of rebellion against Him, and to charge them with it does not rouse conscience. But they cannot but plead guilty to this indictment. God is not in all their thoughts. 2. This attitude is strange and unnatural. That a man should be able to forget God and live as if there were no such being is strange. It is one instance of that awful power of ignoring the most important subjects of which every life affords so many and tragic instances. It seems as if we had above us an opium sky which rains down soporifics. Go that we are fast asleep to to all that it most concerns us to wake to. But still stranger is it that having that power of attending or not attending to subjects, we should so commonly exercise it on this subject. For as the ox that knows the hand that feeds him, and the ass that makes for his master's crib, which he is sure of fodder and straw, might teach us, the stupidest brute has sense enough to recognize who is kind to him, or has authority over him, and where he can find what he needs. The godless man descends below the animal's level, and to ignore him is intensely stupid. But it is worse than foolish. For three, this attitude is voluntary and criminal. Though there is not conscious hostility in it, the root of it is a subconscious sense of discordance with God and of antagonism between his will and the man's. And we are quite sure that we love another and that hearts beat in accord and wills go out towards the same things. We do not need to make efforts to think of that other, but our minds turn towards him or her as to a home, whenever released from the holding back force of necessary occupations. If we love God and have our will set to do his will, our thoughts will fly to him as doves do to their windows. It is fed by preoccupation of thought with things. We have but a certain limited amount of energy of thought or attention, and if we waste it as much as most of us do on things seen and temporal, there is none left of the unseen realities and the God who is eternal, invisible. It is often reinforced by theoretical uncertainty, sometimes real, often largely unreal. But after all, the true basis of it is what Paul gives as its cause. They did not like to retain God in their knowledge. The criminality of this indifference. It is heartlessly ungrateful. Dogs lick the hand that feeds them. Ox and ass in their dull way recognize something almost like obligation rising from benefits and care. Knowing gratitude is meaner and baser than that of which we are guilty, we do not requite him in whose hands our breath is, and whose are all our ways. By even one thankful heartthrob, or one word shaped out of the breath that he gives. 4. This attitude is fatal. It separates us from God, and separation from him is the very definition of death. A God of whom we never think, to know thee. But if Israel doth not know, Israel has slain itself.
Continue.
Okay. What sin does in. Ye shall be as an oak whose leaf fadeth, and as a garden that hath no water. And the strong shall be his toe, and his work as a spark. And they shall both burn together, and none shall quench them. Isaiah 1:30-31. The original reference of these words is to the threatened retribution for national idolatry, of which oaks and gardens were both seats. The nation was, as it were, dried up and made inflammable. The idol was as the spark or the occasion for destruction. But a wider application, which comes home to us all, is to the fatal results in. These need to be very plainly stated because of the deceitfulness of sin, which goes on slaying men by thousands in silence. That grim wolf with privy paw daily devours apace. 1. Sin withers. We see the picture of a blasted tree in the woods, while all around are in full leaf, with tiny leaves half developed and all brown at the edges. A The prophet draws another picture, that of a garden not irrigated, and therefore the burning east given over to barrenness. Sin makes men fruitless and withered. It involves separation from God, the source of all fruitfulness. Psalm 1. How many pure desires and innocent susceptibilities die out of a sinful soul. Think of how many capacities for good disappear. Think of how dry and seared the heart becomes. Think of how conscience is stifled. All sin, any sin, does this. Not only gross, open transgressions, but any piece of godless living will do it. Whatever a man does against his conscience, neglect of duty, habitual unveracity, idleness, in a word, his besetting sin withers him up. And all the while, the evil thing that is drawing his lifeblood, is growing like a poisonous, blotched fungus in a wine cask. Two, sin makes men inflammable, as tow or tinder. A subsidiary reference may be intended to the sinful man as easily catching fire at temptation. But the main thought is that sin makes man ready for destruction, whose end is to be burned. The materials for retribution are laid up in a man's nature by wrongdoing. The conspirators store the dynamite in a dark cellar. Conscience and memory are charged with explosives. If tendencies, habits, and desires become tyrannous by long indulgence and cannot be indulged, what a fierce fire would rage then. We have only to suppose a man made to know what is the real moral character of his actions and to be unable to give them up, to have hell. All this is confirmed by occasional glimpses which men get of themselves. Our own characters are the true Medusa head, which turns a man to stone when he sees it. What then are we really doing by our sins? Piling together fuel for burning. Three, sin burns up. Work as a spark. The evil deeds brought into contact with the doer work destruction. That is, if in a future life, or at any time a man is brought face to face with his acts, then retribution begins. We shake off the burden of our actions by want of remembrance, but that power of ignoring the past may be broken down at any time. Suppose it happens that in another world it can no longer be exercised. What then? Evil deeds are the occasion of the divine retribution. They are a spark. It is they who light the pyre, not God. The prophet here protests in God's name against the notion that he is to be blamed for punishing. Men are their own self-tormentors. The sinful man immolates himself. Like Isaac, he carries the wood and lays the pile for his own burning. Christ severs the connection between us and our evil. He restores beauty and freshness to the blighted tree, planting it as by the river of water, so that it bringeth forth its fruit in its season, and its leaf also doth not wither. Hmm. Let me continue here.
Absolutely. Finish the rest of the time. So.
Okay. Absolutely. The perpetual pillar and cloud of cloud and fire. And the Lord will create over the whole habitation of Mount Zion and over her assemblies a cloud and smoke by day, the shining of a flaming fire by night.
Mm-hmm.
Isaiah 4, verse 5. The pillar of cloud and fire in the Exodus was one. There are to be as many pillars as there are assemblies in the new era. Is it straining the language too much to find significance in that difference? Instead of the formal unity of the old covenant, there is a variety which yet is more vital unity. Is there not a hint here of the same lesson that is taught by the change of the golden lampstand into the seven, which are a better unity because Jesus Christ walks among them? the heart of this promise, thus cast into the form of ancient experiences, but with significant variations, is that of true communion with God. That communion makes those who have it glorious. That communion supplies unfailing guidance. A man in close fellowship with God will have wonderful flashes of sagacity, even about small practical matters. The gleam of the pillar will illumine conscience and shine on many difficult dark places. The simplicity of a saintly soul will often see deeper into the puzzling contingencies than the vulpine craftiness of the prudent. The darker the night, the brighter the guidance. That communion gives a defense. The pillar came between Egypt and Israel and kept the foe off the timid crowd of slaves. Whatever forms our enemies take, fellowship with God will invest us with a defense as protean as our perils. The same cloud is represented in the context as being a pavilion for a shadow in the heat, and for a refuge and for a covert from storm and from rain. A prophet's woes. Woe unto them that join house to house, that lay field to field, till there be no place they may be placed alone in the midst of the earth. In mine ears, said the Lord of hosts, of a truth, many houses shall be desolate, even great and fair, without inhabitant. Yea, 10 acres of vineyard shall yield one bath, and the seed of an omer shall yield an ephah. Woe unto them that rise up early in the morning, that they may follow strong drink, that continue until night, till wine inflame them. And the harp and the viol, the tabret and pipe and wine are in their feasts. But they regard not the work of the Lord, neither consider the operation of his hands. Therefore my people are gone into captivity, because they have no knowledge, and their honorable men are famished, and their multitude dried up with thirst. Therefore hell hath enlarged herself, and opened her mouth without measure. And their glory, and their multitude, and their pomp, and he that rejoiceth shall descend into it. Man shall be brought low, and the mighty man shall be humbled, and the eyes of the lofty shall be humbled. But the Lord of hosts shall be exalted in judgment, and God that is holy shall be sanctified in righteousness. Then shall the lambs feed after their manner, and the waste places of the fat ones shall strangers eat. Woe unto them that draw iniquity with cords of vanity, and sin as if it were a cart rope, that say, let him make speed and hasten his work, that we may see it. And let the counsel of the Holy One of Israel draw nigh and come, that we may know it. Woe unto them that call evil good, and good evil, that put darkness for light and light for darkness, that put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. Woe unto them that are wise in their own eyes and prudent in their own sight. Woe unto them that are mighty to drink wine and the strength to mingle strong drink, which justify the wicked for word and take away the righteous of the righteous from him, the righteousness of the righteous from him. Therefore, as the fire devoureth the stubble, and the flame consumeth the chaff, so their root shall be as rottenness, and their blossom shall go up as dust, because they have cast away the law of the Lord of hosts, and despised the word of the Holy One of Israel. Therefore is the anger of the Lord kindled against his people. and you will lift up an ensign to the nations from afar, and will hiss unto them from the end of the earth. And behold, they shall come with speed swiftly. None shall be weary nor stumble among them. None shall slumber nor sleep. Neither shall the girdle of their loins be loosened, nor the lap of their shoes be broken. Whose arrows are sharp, and all their bows bent, and their horses' hooves shall be counted like flint, and their wheels like a whirlwind. Their roaring shall be like a lion. They shall roar like young lions. Yea, they shall roar, and lay hold of the prey, and shall carry it away safe, and none shall deliver it. And in that day they shall roar against them like the roaring of the sea. And if one look unto the land, behold, darkness and sorrow, and the light is darkened in the heavens thereof.
That's a terrible scene, am I? Sorry.
5, yeah. 8 through 30.
Hmm. The beginning, top of the vineyard, you know.
Brokenness.
Sorry, the beginning of the chapter, yeah. Talking about the Israel, God tenderly has set apart Joel of Egypt as a vineyard, am I? So then, the thing was ruined by their stubbornness rebellion. So go ahead. Mm-hmm.
Drunkenness is, in this text, one of a ring of plague. Sorry, I always
go ahead.
Get mixed up with the dash there. I don't know if he's like doing a
One word or the separation.
Yeah,
me too.
Word.
Yeah.
Drunkenness is, in this text, one of a ring of plague spots on the body politic of Judah. The prophet 6 times proclaims woe as the inevitable end of these. Such sickness is unto death, unless for repentance and another course of conduct bring healing. But drunkenness appears twice in this grim catalogue, in the longest paragraph of denunciation, verses 11 through 17. It's devoted to it. Its connection with the other vices attacked is loose. But it is worth noting that all these have an inner kinship and tend to appear together. They are all in a string, and where a community is cursed with one, the others will not be far away. They are a knot of serpents intertwined. We touch but slightly on the other vices denounced by the prophet's burning words. We premise the general observation that the same uncompromising plainness and boldness in speaking out as to social sins ought to characterize Christian teachers today. The prophet's office is not extinct in the church. The first plague spot is the accumulation of wealth.
What he's saying, the prophet office not extinct in the church.
Yep.
Crazy. Yeah, I was ready to visit with the young ones about where Jesus Christ pronounced woes, you know? Matthew 23. That's interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah, to think about the two set of woes. Yeah. It's a prophetic unction. Anyway, we're hopeful.
Is that where he speaks of the woe of Capernaum being greater than that of Sodom and Gomorrah, their destruction or something?
I think his audience was the religious leader of the day, you know, woe unto you. So the 23, but
okay.
The one you're talking about is the 11th chapter. So yeah,
that's 11th chapter.
Mm-hmm.
Gotcha.
Yeah,
okay.
yeah. Go ahead.
The first plague spot is the accumulation of wealth in a few hands, and the selfish withdrawal of its possessors from the life of the community. In an agricultural society like that of Judah, that clotting of wealth took the shape of land grabbing and of evicting the small proprietors. We see it in more virulent forms in our great commercial centers, where the big men often become big by crushing out the little ones and denude themselves of responsibility to the community in proportion as they clothe themselves with wealth. Rubber wealth is thus congested, and its obligations ignored by selfish indulgence. The seeds are sown which will spring up one day in anarchism. A man need not be a prophet to have it whispered in his ear, as Isaiah had, that the end of selfish capitalism is a convulsion in which many houses shall be desolate, many fields barren. England needs the warning as much as Isaiah's Judah did. Such selfish wealth leads, among other curses, to indolence and drunkenness, as the next woe shows. The people described make drinking the business of their lives, beginning early and sitting late. They have a varnish of art over their swinishness, and must have music as well as wine. So, in many a drink shop in England, a piano or a band adds to the attractions and gives a false air of asceticism to pure animalism. Isaiah feels the incongruity that music should be so prostituted and expresses it by adding to his list of musical instruments and wine, as if he would underscore the degradation of the great art to be the cupbearer of sots. Such revelers are blind to the manifest tokens of God's working, and the operation of his hands excites only the tipsy gaze which sees nothing. That is one of the curses which dog the drunkard, that he takes no warning from the plain results of his vice as seen in others. He knows that it means shattered health, ruined prospects, broken hearts, but nothing rouses him from his fancy of impunity. High, serious thoughts of God and his government, of the world and of each life, are strange to him. His sin compels him to be godless, if he is not to go mad. But sometimes he wakes to a moment's sight of reality. Then he is miserable till his next bout buys fatal forgetfulness. The prophet forces the end of a drunken nation on the unwilling attention of the roisterers in verses 13 through 17, which throb with vehemence of warning and gloomy eloquence. What can such a people come to but destruction? Knowledge must languish, hunger and thirst must follow. Like some monster's gaping mouth, the pit yawns for them, and drawn as by irresistible attraction, the palm and the wicked, senseless jollity, a lie down into it.
What's the Eli? That's an interesting word. Never heard that one before. Slide or?
I would guess. Actually, I'm not quite sure.
Have you heard that word before? I never. Yeah.
Apparently, join together or emerge. So, oh. Kind of like converge together as they make their way down to the same place.
I see. Yeah. Okay. Sorry.
Mm-hmm. Poetic language.
Yeah.
In the universal catastrophe, one thing alone stands upright and is lifted higher, because all else has sunk so far: the righteous judgment of the forgotten God. The grim picture is as true for individuals and their deaths as for a nation and its decay. The modern nations cannot afford to have this ulcer of drunkenness draining away their strength any more than Judah could. By the soul only are the nations great and free, and a people can be neither where the drink fiend has his way. Three woes follow, which are closely connected. That pronounced on daring evildoers, who not only let sin draw them to itself, but go more than halfway to meet it, needing no temptation, drawing it to them eagerly, and scoffing at the merciful warnings of fatal consequences, comes first. Next is a woe on those who play fast and loose with plain morality, sophisticated in conscience and sapping the foundations of law. Such juggling follows sensual indulgence such as drunkenness, when it becomes habitual and audacious, as in the preceding woe. Loose or perverted codes of morality generally spring from bad living, seeking to shelter itself. Vicious principles are an afterthought to screen vicious practices. The last subject of the triple woes is self-conceit and pretense to superior illumination. Such very superior persons are emancipated from the rules which bind the common herd. They are so very clever that they have far outgrown the creeping moralities which may do for old women and children.
Sorry. Think about certain artists. Sorry. Artists, singers, poets, you know, painters, they all think about morality, you know. So, they tell the whole world how to be he. But the life is a shamble. Sorry.
Then Isaiah comes back to his theme of drunkenness, but in a new connection. It poisons the fountain of justice. There is a world of indignant contempt in the prophet's scathing picture of those who are mighty and men of strength. But how is their strength shown? They can stand any quantity of wine and can mix their drinks and yet look sober. What a noble use.
This answer is so candid, insightful. Oh, I like him very much. I wish I could know him, you know. So. Yeah, it would be fun to talk to him. Yeah, go ahead.
These valiant topers are an authority as judges. And they sell their judgments to get money for their debauches. We do not see much of such scandals among us, but yet we have heard of leagues between liquor sellers and municipal authorities, which certainly do not make for righteousness. When shall we learn and practice the lesson that Isaiah was reading his countrymen? That it is fatal to a nation when the private character of public men is regarded as of no account in political and civic life. The prophet had no doubt as to what must be the end of a stage of things in which the very courts of law were honeycombed with corruption and demoralized by the power of drink. His tremendous image of a fierce fire raging across a dry prairie and burning the grass to its very roots while the air is stifling with the thick dust of the conflagration proclaims the sure fate, sooner or later, of every community and individual that rejects the law of the Lord of hosts and despises the word of the Holy One of Israel. Change the name and the tale is told of us. Change the name and the tale is told of us. For it is righteousness that exalteth the nation, and no single vice drags after it more infallibly such a multitude of attendant demons as the vice of drunkenness, which is a crying sin of England today. Only like a few decades before the Great Prohibition in America. That's interesting.
I think it might parallel, actually, so I'm not too sure, so yeah.
I was thinking he was later 19th century, but yeah, maybe you're right.
Yeah, I don't know. So around that time, you know, so yeah. I was thinking about that as well. I said, why does it do those things? You know, prohibition? Is it because wine, whatever, making it, take a lot of grain, you know? Lot of food resources. And people go hungry those days, you know? So yeah, don't have anything to eat. So it's a more.
Just so many people were living such a drunk lifestyle.
As well, yeah. It's terrible.
Family.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Charles Dickens often talk about the drunkenness in his novels. It's a lot of fun.
Yeah.
Man, you know, the more desperate, poor, actually, people like to drink. That's our situation when I grew up. Certain people get drunk, you know, all day long almost. So, yeah. This life is miserable, you know, so no hope, so, yeah.
Definition of miserable. Yeah.
But, you know, everything in the moderation, you know. So, and well, anyway, that's beyond the topic here. So, Noah, why don't you wrap up for us? Mm-hmm.
Of course. Lord, even as a young man, in my earlier days, Lord, the beauty of something like moderation has always captivated me, Lord, in a way to go about living life and assessing one's inner character, Lord, the things that attract a young heart, and Lord, having tasted the fruits of overindulging in things and the bitterness that leads to, Lord, every heart that has experienced such things yearns for a peace and a confidence that comes through a balanced life, Lord, finding the golden mean in, Lord, the way that one carries oneself throughout life. And Lord, this is this desire to know this this moderation, Lord, it's not lessened within me, and I ask that it would be something learned and at least yearned for by the young people in our midst, Lord, as such a treasure to have in this life, Lord, the threshold of true wisdom, Lord, which comes through first disciplining oneself and putting one's heart in a right place in respect to the manner in which we live our lives and relate to one another, the recognition that comes through through this process as Lord, lives which stand as examples for other lives, Lord, not to live our lives as if every action we take is only of consequence to ourselves, Lord, but bears an effect upon the lives that observe ours. Lord, if this would be a thing that we could awake, that you would awake within the hearts of our younger generation here, Lord, I think it would bring, Lord, such substantial change and growth. Lord, the habits, the bad habits that each of us struggle with, Lord, will be realized only as fruits of a deeper heart issue, Lord, of a root that must be dealt with, that has to do with life perspective. And Lord, I just pray for a renewal in our community of Lord, the hearts that do earnestly seek you, Father, that still remain in some confusion, Lord, as to why their lives go about in a certain way. So Lord, may we steadily but confidently go forward in our obedience to you and dealing with these things, and Lord, that it would bring, even as I prayed earlier, Lord, the process of this would bring great joy and transformation to each family. So Lord, we just continue to pray for your guidance in all of this. Pray these things in Jesus' name.
Amen. Jesus' name. Well, bless you. It's always so encouraging to hear your prayer, spend time with you. Yeah. Have a great day, okay, Noah? Yeah.
You
okay.
As well.
Okay. Right. Okay. Bye. Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah.
Bye.
Yeah.